All right, we are back. This is Late Night in the Midlands. I'm Michael Guerra, and sitting in with me tonight is Glenn Kennedy of ProjectInsurance.com, and our guest tonight, Gary the Mad Martian. And he's laying it out for you step by step here as it went down, putting the whole scenario in perspective and doing a fantastic job of that as well. And I know that there were some, such as Richard, who actually told me,
"You're despicable."
Oh, did you hear when he was on with Peter Kling? Nobody's going to get the message. He's going to scream and yell and...
I think that I am familiar with the fact that you are going to ignore this particular problem until it swims up and bites you on the ass.
No, we're saving that for the end.
Go away. I don't want anything from you. Scram. Damn!
But we're going to get the message out here tonight, that's for sure, because that's what we do here on Late Night in the Midlands.
Every time.
Oh, yeah. And so let's get back to it. And, okay, Glenn, you're back with me. And, Gary, you are back. And you could pick right back up, my friend. You're doing a great job.
Thank you, bro. I appreciate it, you know. And that's the thing, the opportunity for this. Because in order to lay out the story, I have to lay out, and the story has the timeline of my investigations and what I was finding, too, and what I have found out. So I'm trying to lay that all within this. So it'll, believe me, it'll save a lot of time. Everyone had a headache before in the past when I was trying to see things and put these things together, and I can understand that, but I did it for a reason. You see, I wanted to show my work. And so if I was right, any of the seeds that I planted, another scene that if they look, say, a few months later, believe me, they'll want to, not every day. Oh, who could stand it? Even me. But the thing is, if they go months, you know, and then compare to what previous, compared to what where it was going, it was consistent and it was getting more solid. And that's the beauty of this. And what I'm trying to describe out here, as weird as it sounds, there's a code applied to all this, even in his words then. But anyway, so he asked for the producer. I think that's where we left off at, right?
Yes,
you know,
sir.
Get him the number. It only took me a couple of days, many hours, but that was after the time he asked me. That was, remember, June, what, 2nd? Okay, 2006. But and I had found him. I had finally communicated with him, the main producer. He's a very busy man. I was luckily and thankful to get in touch with him and him to reply to me and be very, very kind. The man is amazing. He surprised me. But and I'm talking about Charles E. Cellier, okay, executive producer of the UFO Diaries, okay,
Gary,
president of Grizzly Adams Productions. Now, all right, before I go on, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, I just wanted you to tell everybody, because a lot of people out there might remember that show Grizzly Adams, and this guy is a heavy hitter, you know. He's not just some schmuck off the street, you know. So I just wanted
to
mention.
Movies, movies behind his name, not just Grizzly Adams. Remember Big Ben, everyone? I know a couple of my buddies out there do, and older folk, but newer ones know. But many PAX TV shows, religious shows, miracles and other wonders, and always talking about codes in his shows. The man is a genius. Okay, I still say is because his essence and his spirit was in this, as Richard is going to get the message of. And it may spook some, but it's meant for him, okay? And us all, too, because of the technology that this is. This is technology of what I'm going to be describing to you people. Remember, this is our car, so you hear it again. You'll go over it. It sounds nuts now, but believe me, it'll get clearer if you follow the data. And that's what I'm trying to lay out. So, August 4th, I got in touch with Mr. Cellier. Okay, and I want to read his reply first before I read what Richard's reply to my success of getting him. August 4th, okay, Gary, oh my goodness, you got to be kidding me. I didn't mean to touch the button. Yeah. But everyone is on that page, the main evidence page that has all the pictures. You got to scroll down to the letters, which I'm doing now because it had to refresh.
Okay,
it's okay. Doing it. Okay, I'm sorry about this, people, and might take more time. We got a lot to cover tonight, and I hope we really, you know, can cover enough bases as this is loading. I'll explain.
We could go an extra hour if we have to.
Oh, that's cool. You know, to then take calls. We were not going to take calls for quite some time on this, so people ringing those lines, well, do what you want to do until you get the go-ahead, because there's a lot to go on here. And so, all right, it's coming down. Let me see. I'll get to the point because this is important. Come on. And thanks for putting me on one page, Mike. I appreciate that. That helps. That should help everybody. Takes time to learn for people, but that is meat on the bone. All right? Okay, I'm there. So August 4th, Mr. Cellier replies back, Gary, all of these images were licensed from others at the time we did the production. These files came from Richard Hoagland. Why would he be needing them from me? Okay, because that was in my email sent to him, which is seen there, well, a clip from it. Here are the image examples of what we desperately need and is important to do to the Mars research, which it is. Other faces, I just showed him some clips. So he's referring to those. So the files, he says, these files came from Richard Hoagland. Guess what he's talking about? He's talking about those clips of those faces. Okay, and under that image, we'll see three in a row, one, two, three, well, four, because you got a little example to look at these others to judge these faces that is not that same face as Cydonia.
Surely no intelligent life could survive there.
So in that image, under that under that email there, with Mr. Cellier's words, you can see these faces, one above the other, okay, and compare it to the Cydonia Viking face there. Clearly not the same. All right. So,
Gary, that was the shocking thing to me, too, is that the whole time Richard's like, oh, I can't remember, those images could have been fakes, blah, 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 and then it turns out that the producer just says, no, those were Richard's images, and that's what really shocked me for the first, I guess, part of the story.
And, well, that's incredible, isn't it? And that's the thing, yeah. You know, because we're being, like you said, the producers, you cannot get more credible than Charles E. Cellier. All right, I'm going to tell you right now, he's a devout Christian. He's been through many, even Mormonism. He's a spiritual soul who found Jesus. All right, and I don't care what people think of that out there. I'm one, too, and thanks to Mr. Cellier, hey, I have a debt to pay to Mr. Cellier, and that's why I'm here fighting, too, because this is his work, too, and we'll get into why maybe, you know, this maybe code was kind of done, but someone screwed a lot of things up. But anyway, Mr. Cellier then sends me another email. Hey, Gary, you are beginning to worry me. Oh, I'm like, uh-oh, what do I do? You know, UFO Diaries was produced over 12 years ago. It sounds to me like you and Richard Hoagland are wanting some footage to do a new show. And I'm like, oh, no. Oh, my gosh, is he thinking I'm trying to con him or something? And then he goes, I haven't done much in UFOs for a long time. Is this what this interview is all about? And, you know, and we had other conversations, you know, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, I wound up getting him as a guest on the show. I remember. So, now the Richard Hoagland. Scroll a couple images up. You'll see Richard's email to me there about Mr. Chuck Cellier's Grizzly Adams Productions image. All right? Gary! This was August 4th, 1-08, whatever. Gary, congratulations on getting Cellier on the show. Remember, if you record it properly, it can be run later on WMEL. Smiley face. He loves those smiley faces. Well, he always leaves out the nose. I wonder why. Is it because I don't know. But even before that, you'll have more audience on the net. Oh, this is where he's insulting WMEL. Though he's right, but he doesn't have to sound insulting. But even before that, you'll have more audience on the net, especially via Enterprise, than WMEL's entire broadcast audience anyway. Smiley face again. As for the rest, I really am having a hard time seeing your code in this TV program. Oh, Mr. Hoagland, you know, you're still stuck in that swamp, huh? I'm kind of clearing up your TV screen a little bit here. Hopefully for others as well. But anyway, I'm willing to be shown. Are you? And why aren't you here?
Well, I'm suspicious.
I'm willing to be shown, but I haven't seen any compelling evidence of such a code as yet. Really? We just went over one. Go back to that opening line of that video. You people can hear it. And look at the image I helped put together to help people for the visionary impaired. Okay? It's a mathematical problem. You have to do math to figure out the fourth world. And not only that, it's a model. It's a model who belongs to who? Ours. That's key. That's key. Go ahead. I'm going to make my point, but go ahead.
Yeah, Gary, I just want to say something real quick. you know, what's surprising about all of this is that you basically, you know, get the producer, and the producer says that those are Hoagland's images, and then Hoagland doesn't even really address that point. It's almost like he doesn't even hear you anymore, and he says he doesn't see any code, but, you know, why didn't he even respond?
Well, I'm suspicious.
You know, did he ever say, yes, those were my images, or, oh, I remember now, or did he just kind of blow off the whole thing? Because I'm assuming that you showed him the email from the producer saying that those were Hoagland's images, or did you just tell
him? As a matter of fact, didn't he even say that, oh, those must be props, so you don't know how TV works?
Yeah, that's what he said.
When Mr. Sellier gave me that, something told me and me, hide it.
Yeah.
Don't tell him. Because I didn't know what to think. Let's put it this way. After all the whoop-de-doos I went through with this and the places I lived at, there must be stains of soda all around my chair for how many times I dropped my glass. You know, I mean, there's a lot of spooky, weird things to this. And, you know, and it all falls a lot to this code thing.
UFO diaries in the region designated as Sedonia.
Sunset.
All right, and Mr. Holden's own words, even.
Which are our pictures.
Surely no intelligent life could survive there.
All right, but this paves the way to... I'm trying to show the pattern here and to lay out the evidence from the images, because it's to show the pattern of what the article you guys wrote on me. Again, thank you. Got a lot of meat out. It explains, and it will explain, okay? And I'll explain it, all right? And he had his chance to explain his. Now explain mine. Okay, so as for the rest, all right, we got that. No coders yet. I know how disorganized and non-planned television is. Okay, you know, on the surface, that looks great, right? I mean, that's true. He would know. You know, he's around TV and a lot of people.
Sure.
Well, I can respect that. But now looking deep into that, I know how disorganized and non-planned television is. What television, Mr. Hoagland, were you really referring to? UFO Diaries? How disorganized it was? How non-planned things turned out to be? Well, I'm sure you didn't plan on having this come back up in your bite you, did you? Well, you know, I mean, but I think he was attributing his knowledge of what he did to the Cydonia Sunset based upon the producer's own words, especially Mr. Lee Shackelford. That man is also another genius, and his shows should be watched, and he also does plays. Gulliver is good, too, if you know Gulliver's Travels. I mean, you guys should check him out. He's a man.
He also did Star Trek Next Generation series work as well, so he did some of those episodes, I guess.
Exactly. So, I mean, so these guys are not just, you know, a couple of schmucks hanging out against the wall somewhere.
In a Masonic lodge.
You know, and found this Holy Grail. These guys are the Holy Grail. You cannot get better testimonies from what these gentlemen had to say. And I appreciate the help that they gave me and all that they said, because I see it. I see a lot. And Mr. Hoagland, I see the same thing in you. But both of you two are at war with each other. But we'll get into that later. So, he knows how disorganized and unplanned television is. Yeah, especially when it's created by people who really haven't done their homework on something as complicated as investigating Cydonia. Boom. He's talking, you know, on the surface, and that's true. A lot of people don't do their research Cydonia. So this one's researcher's presentation is different or less than others. That makes sense, right? Hoagland's supposed to be the guy who's the master of that, right?
Right.
You man of Mars, you. Anyway, but he goes, especially when it's created by people who really haven't done their homework on something as complicated as investigating Cydonia. He's talking about people who haven't done the complicating homework as investigating Cydonia, which we know is what now?
UFO diaries in the region designated as Cydonia.
Sunset.
So people haven't done their homework, and therefore this is complicating? And it was for me back then, but less now. Look where we're at now. But bottom line, you sure? We still need those NASA ID numbers for those additional face images. He was taunting me, you know, and therefore I know now well, check this out. This is incredible if you think about this. We still need those NASA ID numbers. He might as well be going, for those additional face images, because he in code, if I'm right, guys, in code, What I just said, that he's speaking in code and referring back to that UFO diaries, hell, no one does their homework. We still need those NASA ID numbers for those, right. You know, for those additional face images.
And,
why
and
say that
is,
for what he just said? He was connecting to what investigating Cydonia, the video.
UFO diaries in the region designated as Cydonia.
Not just people on the random making up videos, you know, just talking about the normal stuff of Cydonia. He's talking about complicated doing the homework is on that video of Cydonia.
UFO diaries in the region designated as Cydonia.
And that's why he said for those additional face images. So that's a connection. You see where I'm going?
And what's amazing about what's amazing about his whole attitude, Gary, is that, you know, here he is at telling you we need those, you know, those numbers, those NASA numbers, but he's supposed to be the one with the NASA contacts. Why isn't he getting off his butt?
Well, remember what he said in the previous message I read already? He said we have to find a NASA original. Therefore, we did. It's Hoagland, thanks to Mr. Cellier. Okay.
We got them from Hoagland, we got them from NASA, and there you are. I mean, one of them's going to say, yeah, those are ours.
Which are our pictures.
So now that we found the NASA original.
Dr. Hoagland.
Richard, will you please give me those original Viking numbers for those additional face images where you even admitted one of them, if it turns out to be real, would be an extraordinary work of Martian art. I want that image. I want to study that art, you know?
I mean, one of them's going to say, yeah, those are ours.
You know? Whatever. Let's continue on. Okay, so.
Yeah, so he's basically, he's wanting you to do all the work, which is very suspicious at this point. He's not interested at all in lifting a finger. So he's telling you that we need this, we need these data and so forth. So basically what happens next?
Okay. All right. Now I have Mr. Cellier on. He's done.
The fascination of the faces on Mars for me and my fascination with Richard Hoagland, who's been the big mover and shaker in all of that.
Yeah. All right, you primitives. Listen up. See this?
UFO diaries in the region designated as Cydonia.
This?
UFO diaries. Cydonia.
Sunset.
Is my boomstick! The 12-gauge double-barreled Remington.
Of intelligence.
S-Mart's top of the line.
In a Masonic lodge.
You can find this in
the UFO diaries. Cydonia.
Sunset.
The sporting goods department. That's right, sweet baby, was made in...
In a Masonic lodge.
It's got a walnut stock, cobalt blue steel, and a hair trigger. That's right. Shop smart. Shop S-Mart. You got that? Now I swear, the next one of you primates even touches me. Yeah!
The fascination of the faces on Mars for me and my fascination with Richard Hoagland, who's been the big mover and shaker in all of that. We got them from Hoagland, we got them from NASA, and there you are. I mean, one of them's going to say, yeah, those are ours.
Which are our pictures.
Let's talk about how I get back home.
He's done. And that's when he ran. He was supposed to appear on the record with Mr. Cellier and I. Okay? Why didn't he show up? He was supposed to show up with Mr. Shackelford and I. I had Mr. Shackelford on before I had Mr. Cellier. Okay? And I'm sorry. Go ahead. What?
Was he supposed to be on your radio show, Hoagland?
Well, yeah, he said, congratulations, get him on. I mean, but we've had phone conversations, which I didn't record. I should have. And that's another thing. Before I continue on, I feel real horrible doing this. But it's part of the evidence, and I'm only using the things from private and outside sources that connects to the investigation. I'm not getting any other personal, you know, and all this other stuff that was attributed and going on and all this on both sides, not just mine, but the stuff connected to where I'm leading this, where I'm trying to show you his actions for months, so steering this and setting me up.
He was supposed to be on the show with Sellier, and what? He just never shows up? I mean, what's his excuse?
Something always came up. Which I understand, he's a busy man. And, you know, like I said before, I was always, every time he was on, he was more than welcome. You know, and
he never misses a coast to coast show.
Well, no, actually, sometimes he has, and George has been pissed at him in the past for being on mine. But we'll not get into that now, will we, Mr. Snorri? But anyway, so when Mr. Shackelford was on, you know, oh boy, do you have that clip, Mike?
Is there any way maybe I can get copies of these images that were used, or am I being out of my bounds? I don't mean to disrespect.
No. I think these are in the crate somewhere right next to the Ark of the Covenant.
When I asked Mr. Shackelford, hey, you know, is there any way that it would be possible for me to get these images in my hands? I don't mean disrespect, which I didn't. And I don't know why I even said that, but, oh, my gosh, I'm glad I did. I don't mean disrespect, even to them now. And Mr. Sellier's, let's just say, associates are well aware of that. I'm all for Mr. Sellier, and I'm fighting for him. He helped me. He saved me where someone tried to destroy me. But, again, later on, I'm jumping ahead. So, is there any way I can get any of these images in my hands? I know, Mr. Shackelford, I don't mean disrespect. And he goes, no. I mean, these are somewhere right next to the Ark of the, you know, in the crate next to the Ark of the Covenant. Now, think about that comment. Now, but then, all right, so boom, switch along. As I said, of course, it would be, I'd be appreciative for the whole Mars research and overall and, you know, everyone else. And for Mr. Hoagland, because, you know, he really wanted to be here tonight. But because other more pressing matters were at hand. And then Mr. Shackelford laughed. And I'm thinking to myself in time, I was like, why would he laugh? More pressing matters were at hand. And then he goes, well, you said the magic words there. And I'm thinking to myself, what? What do you mean? Well, you said the magic words there. What words? Oh, more pressing matters were at hand. Joke on someone else. And then he goes, well, like I just said before, I feel like I owe him something. Yeah, we'll get into that, won't we?
Richard Hoagland, it would be a big help to him, too, because he is interested in knowing more about these images, too. And he wishes that he could join us tonight, but pressing matters were at hand.
Well, you said the magic words there.
But pressing matters were at hand.
Because, like I said before, I feel like I owe him something.
But anyway, so I know that's why. But the thing Mr. Hoagland had to say, Mr. Shackelford, not surprised, obviously, Hoagland didn't want to show up. We learned why, because of Mr. Shackelford's story. I don't know if you played all that, Mike, but I will embed that in the show, and I will provide you the late archive for that if you want it, okay? Anyway, where Mr. Shackelford basically lays out a story where, on the surface, you know, he just cannot explain that. You know, I can't explain that, or I just wasn't there, you know, but, you know, you know what I mean? But the thing is, you know, admitting basically that a code was made for that Cydonia sunset, you know, something had to be done. Why? Oh, my God. Well, that, you know, because of Mrs. Patterson's... okay, now we get into this. This is going to get good, people. All right.
From the beginning was this idea, I think this is Chuck's idea, that there should be a sort of a room, sort of a treasure room.
Of intelligence.
Where this guy can walk through and he can pick things up.
Of intelligence.
What they've done is they've filled this room with this random collection of, well, space junk. And some of it is very convincing and it seems to be taken seriously. I noticed looking at Chuck's biography online here, in an Internet Movie Database, that I've been seeing in the stores a video called Breaking the Da Vinci Code, and he's the supervising producer of that.
Oh, no kidding.
So I'm glad to see he's back in the business.
Yeah, codes.
Exactly, yes. But you know what? You put your finger right on it. Those are the things that have always interested him. What's going on behind the surface of the things that we can see?
Yes.
You know, those are the stories that he's always been interested in telling. And so UFO Diaries was a real natural.
So,
well, who caught this? I mean, I'm thinking about how many people working on the show look at these pictures.
Yeah, it seems to be I'm the only one.
Yeah.
And all these years later, all the power, right?
Yeah. But that's I think that's something to be proud of. That's a keen eye. What you've got here are screen grabs.
Yes.
From the video, is that right?
Yes, sir.
Because the quality is actually really, it's much better than I would have thought. So by the time I finally saw that one on tape, It was just unrecognizable. And I can only imagine, this is sort of, you know, the part that I'm not really proud of. I'm looking at a screen grab here, one of the Face on Mars, mysterious pictures that you send me by email.
Right.
And that's one of the scenes that I scripted. But I remember that when they finally did it in production, you can tell watching it, they're largely improvising that dialogue. They've got the gist of what was supposed to be in the script. But,
improvising the dialogue, huh?
The planet Mars is next to our own. The fourth world, counting out from the sun. Surely no intelligent life could survive there.
It's not that anybody decided, let's make it look like this. I think it's just sort of how it ended up looking.
Huh.
You know what I mean? And it just seemed to me we had suddenly gone down with a bump from being a show that was trying to be very professional to being something really amateur. And I know Chuck must have been heartbroken about that, too, because, you know, it's something he was putting a lot of his own resources into. Uh-huh. And everybody else involved there was, too.
The planet Mars is next to our own. The fourth world, counting out from the sun. Surely no intelligent life could survive there.
Well, we just always knew that the show was going to have to be done very much on the cheap, and that the whole idea was to put this together as quickly and as cleanly and as smartly as we could.
Our technology could be just a lot smarter than we think it is.
And as I was telling you the other day, but the big thing that was supposed to happen with Cydonia was we were supposed to have Dr. Hoagland.
Really?
And this show had really been scripted around it.
Maybe it's just me, but I believe we're going to have to get medieval on your buttocks.
We were going to have Dr. Hoagland taking us through all of his
Face on Mars mysterious pictures
of intelligence,
theories and thoughts and discoveries and ideas about Cydonia. And then suddenly, we didn't have that anymore.
Well, maybe if he read the script that it was already written for him to say whatever, maybe he said, oh, forget it.
If that was what his problem was and why he didn't want to do the interview.
Well, I don't know.
Then he was the only one, but yeah. But
his memory needs to be refreshed, too. He doesn't remember any of this.
UFO Diaries. That was the name of the special.
And I don't think the show was supposed to be anything but respectful to his
UFO Diaries.
Face on Mars, mysterious pictures.
Views.
Of intelligence.
In a Masonic lodge.
Right.
Then we would get, you know, Dr. Hoagland, and Dr. Hoagland would sit in front of a camera, and Dr. Hoagland would say, we would hope, Dr. Hoagland would answer questions, and Dr. Hoagland would say something that was like what we'd written for. Dr. Hoagland, based on things Dr. Hoagland written, you know, this is all coming from Dr. Hoagland literature anyway, so we're not asking Dr. Hoagland to say anything in theory again.
Uh-huh.
But Dr. Hoagland, we would disagree with. You know, because we're putting their own words back in their mouth. So this has been going on for a while. But I am thinking somebody in production knows what happened to all those photos. Just because I saw how they were putting them up. Literally, they're getting, hey, you guys who are over there.
Of intelligence.
You know, sweeping the floor.
In a Masonic lodge.
Come over here and help us stick some of these pictures up. I mean, it's literally like that.
Wow.
You know, I remember, I was there and we'd go, No, Joe, we've already seen that. What else you got? What else you got? Throw this up. Throw that up. Pull this big thing over here.
Is there any way maybe I can get copies of these images that were used? Or am I being out of my bounds? I don't mean to disrespect.
No. I think these are in the crate somewhere right next to the Ark of the Covenant.
Pull this big thing over here. Go see what this lodge has that we can add to make it look weirder.
So, that's really what happened. That's why the episode that you see is the way it is, because suddenly there was this script with these big holes in it, all these things that Dr. Hoagland was supposed to say. We kept getting Dr. Hoagland in front of the camera, and Dr. Hoagland, for whatever reason, Dr. Hoagland wouldn't say what we'd scripted for. Dr. Hoagland.
All right, here we go. Right back to his words again.
Which are our pictures.
Because this falls back to the woman. This is the one who produces testimony of this woman who Richard originally made a comment, and I really want to read this for you, because it's important, okay? It shows credibility. It shows credibility. It shows issues of, you people put it together. I'm not trying to convince you. As you can see, I'm trying to lay out data. And if you want to follow that data, you got to take notes. You will be here in this archive. And do your own work, all right? I'm in my fight. I just hope I'm not going to be standing alone after this. And I'm talking as I'm trying to find this image so I don't waste both of our time, okay? Or create dead air.
All right.
So,
I think
you talk in the meantime.
Yeah, I'll just say I think you're probably looking for the image of the lady with the glasses. Is that the one you're looking for?
Right, but I'm looking for Hoagland's reply
I think
to my question. I'm coming up to it, I think. Bingo, I found it.
Okay, go ahead.
All right. Now before he said, before about asking about the woman, when he said, you know, Photoshop, remember about the Photoshop thing? I sent a message, I posted a message that said, you know what, I didn't fake these images, blah, blah, blah. So, Hoagland's reply on 6-2, again, still 6-2, the same date as everyone, no one was accusing you of using Photoshop on this. It's a simple frame grab from the video, right? I met the producers of the original series. Bam! We got them. No, what's the problem there? Just the same day, what, an hour before, Richard, you don't remember who the producers were? Now you're charging them with the allegation of fraud to a video that had no debunking tone whatsoever in it? I mean, no. Look, people, you got to feel my stress, and I apologize, but this is the data. This is what is the fact. It all falls back to how important this video is. Hell with me, you're going to say sooner or later, because many of you are going to come to see this yourselves, especially if you follow out the work I'm doing. And then Mr. Hoagland, well, I don't know what to tell you.
Gary,
find a retire.
Gary, he also gives it away, too, when he says the producers. If he didn't even know who produced it, how would he even know that there was more than one producer for the show?
You know what? That's a good point, too.
And Lee Shackelford and I wrote every one of the episodes.
Well, then I'm sorry about any what may sound like accusational tones and stuff like this.
There you go, Glenn. You just added to the principal investigator here of this investigation. Your voice on the record.
Yeah, but let's move on. So he's basically saying that this thing's just all made up and blah, blah, blah. So go ahead.
Yep. So then, you know, I meant the producers. So he's accusing the producers. Then he goes, and yes, I was using Photoshop and all its equivalents back in 95. Well, maybe 95, but this was put out in 93. You know, I mean, come on. You know, now I know this. Now we know this because my investigation didn't get that far to know that Hoagland's not the truth there, right? So, nothing, now get this description. Nothing very fancy would be required to lift this new face from the original 35A72, paste it onto another Viking Martian landscape image, move the bit hits, there we go again, the bit hits around the smidge, etc., take about 20 minutes. And yes, it did, Richard, because now we got you photographed where you've not wished to be photographed before. So you're right. Thanks for the instruction manual.
The fascination of the faces on Mars for me and my fascination with Richard Hoagland, who's been the big mover and shaker and all of that.
But anyway, so there we go again. Here we go. So we must, in capital letters, find the NASA original. ... If we're serious, of course. He goes back to the serious, of course, and mentioning about the NASA original. Remember now, we know who that is. NASA and Hoagland are one and the same. Mr. Sellier connected them.
We got them from Hoagland, we got them from NASA, and there you are. I mean, one of them's going to say, yeah, those are ours.
One of him's going to say, yeah, those are ours. Not one of them as two separate organizations. On the surface, that's what everyone would be thinking of his words. But when you look into it, you can see where we're being steered. One of him?
One of them's going to say, yeah, those are ours.
Which are our pictures.
Hoagland was a NASA consultant, and we do have a story I'm going to break in the future connecting him again to images and being a NASA consultant, walking in on a Friday, leaving on a Monday. But anyway, that's another show. I just want to throw that out there for a tickle, you know?
I mean, I was a NASA consultant. I had to sign certain documents. For the first time on the air, an ask
Richard Hoagland, a member of our team of intelligence,
who was a member of the military, admitted I had to sign certain documents. I mean, I was a NASA consultant. Fortunately, because I wasn't dealing with secret material. And I wasn't likely to come into contact with ruins on the imagery that I was dealing with. Nothing personally was involved with, you know, Leavenworth or sanctions if I should see something that I wasn't supposed to, and I would talk about it.
UFO Diaries.
Face on Mars, Mysterious Pictures.
But anyway, let me scroll down. When I asked him about the woman, because it took him two days, I didn't get a reply. I replied, Captain, is this lady I asked you of in an earlier reply named Shannon? Now, Mike, this touches on something you did, and I'm glad you did, because now this is more code. Captain, is this lady I asked you of in an earlier reply named Shannon? a part of your investigating team, the artist for it. And I go, Captain, I don't know why I have not heard, you know, another reply, how many hours later? The next day. I go, Captain, I don't know why I have not heard from you about this. I need to know if this is Shannon. Who was an artist for your research team back when this footage of you was in the video? Because that's what said. Mike, you brought that out before that woman with the picture is seen, and he goes, this is a sketch done by Shannon. Then it clicks to the woman.
That's right.
In our on the surface, in our minds, we're thinking her name is Shannon, right? Why? But, yes, she holds up a picture, all right? And when she puts it next to a Sphinx, a picture, who's not looking at the picture. If you look at these faces of Mars, you will always see a Sphinx looking toward it or looking down at it. Okay? That Sphinx that you see on the wall is an identity. It represents maybe an identity or identities of people who are looking and seeing what it's looking at, these new faces. Okay? So when he says this is a sketch done by Shannon, and they use a Hoagland clip where he's at the UN and he's got a picture of a drawing of the face on Mars, ironically or coincidentally, Mike, I think you notice this too, the drawing of the representation of that face looks like Hoagland's face. But anyway, now think about this connection. It's symbolic. Why? Okay, this is a sketch done by Shannon. Do a definition word on the word sketch. It's a short skit, a mini play, and everything. Wow, done by Shannon. Richard, who's this woman? Is her name Shannon? Oh, no, first of all, you need a little background in today's television. He was snotty. That was on the 5th, okay, after, you know, my wanting to know. And he goes, the folks depicted in this film, I've done a bit of research, really, regarding which series this was I was interviewed for. Oh, my God. We got him from June 1st, or June 2nd, rather, coming out, second day, you know, where's this thing on Mars? I don't know the producers, the memory, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. Now it's the 5th. I asked him about the woman on the 4th and the 5th. You could clearly see that in those images as evidence. This is evidence. Yeah. All right? And on the 5th, okay, where he says this, he goes, the folks depicted in this film, parentheses, I've done a bit of research. Which series this was I was interviewed for? Really, Richard? And why? Where the hell is it? Why didn't you tell us it there? I mean, you know, that's what we're asking you about. We don't want to be clued in that you've done a bit of research. Of course, I did all the, you know, legwork later, but this was still way before I could. You know, I was still finding his number, you know, looking for the legwork for him. I was doing my job. Now, so, let me calm down. So, yeah. Right, the folks depicted in this film, I've done a bit of research regarding which series this was. Oh, I don't remember producers, this and that. Okay, we got the point. He didn't obviously tell us. Except for me and the other experts also being interviewed, we're all, wait for it, fakes. Boom. Actors playing the role of research staff, artists, photo experts, etc. Yeah. Now, Richard, in a way, is telling the truth. And that's how it would be in videos. So on the surface, his reply looks innocent, right? I mean, you know, I mean, I admit that until I started learning this lingo and seeing into this. And now I'm seeing, because the fact of the matter of this is a sketch done by Shannon, a short clip, a quick play, something quickly put together. Why? We were told by Mr. Shackelford why. All right, but let me continue on before I tell you what he said. All right? That's what television had descended to these days. Even National Geographic specials, they're called recreations. Oh, and we got a big word for this. Really? They're called recreations. Okay. A short script, a short play. Now, remember, if this is a sketch, right? A sketch, a short play, and therefore, being a recreation. What happened to the old creation? You know what I'm saying? If this is a recreation, this being a sketch, a quick, short play, something thrown together fast, she, in that video, is the recreated part. What happened to the old creation? I want to see those pre-production tapes. I bet I'm right. And Mr. Sellier kind of hinted that we would see things, that we would get to hear and see. Even the director, though we couldn't know who, bring a name or a picture who the director was, but we would hear the director in that video, in the pre-production. I'm betting it's Hoagland. But anyway, or someone else. someone else that doesn't want to be seen in this. And so I can respect that.
So Gary,
a recreation would definitely indicate an original is present somewhere as well.
Thank you. So obviously I'm not bonkers now, right? I mean, you're seeing my mindset.
Right.
I'm trying to lay out my mindset because this has also been arisen against me, like I'm the one on the damn trial here, and it's
The bottom line is that you've caught Richard just throughout this whole process and lie after lie after lie. It just seems like...
But Glenn, the beauty of this, at the same time he's doing that, he's coding and giving me information as if he's encouraging it. That's right. The strange thing about this, and we will get into that later. I know now this really sounds nuts. Can I make up my mind? You must be thinking. No, I'm trying to tell you where the data is leading me, okay? And this is a test. This is a test, and I intend to pass this test. I want my show back and be worthy to solve this. I can't do my show again since this is what destroyed it. I need to finish this, bring it back as my crown.
Right. Gary, let's move to the next phase of the story where basically it seemed like at one point, and I don't know when this was, maybe shortly after, he started getting more nice to you. He almost said that...
Jumping far ahead. You see, okay. I'm going to be honest and I'm going to be open here right now. I'm worried about my life and he's got my family scared. All right? Now, I didn't want to tell anybody this, but because, you know, I can understand this is taking time. All right? But there's a lot of media. Look, this is over 5 years of research. Okay? It's not going to come out 15 minutes. Please have patience with me. And Glenn, I'm not trying to insult you. I appreciate everything you're doing. Believe me. But please understand, everything that Hoagland had been recently saying, along with his little Tweety bird there that he pimps out the bum money from his own Facebook fans, I mean, you know, that's pretty disgusting in itself. But anyway, slandering me, saying all the things he's doing, it's overwhelming. My family's scared because of what was done to us in the past. They're worried now. Well, now, you know, you were getting close then. Look what happened to us now. Look at you. You have all these people listening. What's going to happen to us now? How do you address your family and keep them calm and something like that? Huh?
Right.
Richard, payback is coming. And I'm calling you out, and I'm not the only one. You will see that either by the end of this show or the next one. And guess what, Rich? The next one. And the next one. And the next one. Now, let's continue on. That's what television has descended to these days. They're called recreations. So this technician with glasses, again, the woman, remember my question? Who, Mike, you've seen that? The sketch? We now know what that means. So this technician with glasses isn't a real person at all. Notice he puts the words in parentheses, technician with glasses. He's implying, okay, if she's a fake or whatever, a prop, but yes, she's a technician. And what? A technician with who? Well, we're going to get into who this woman is, and that's what pissed them off. But she's a prop, just like the computer monitor I used in the show. Now, this don't make sense, because Richard is thinking of another show here. He gave himself away. He was in more than one show of Cellulars talking about Mars. She's a prop, just like the computer monitor I used in the show. Richard, in UFO Diaries, you're not at a monitor in the show or sitting in a chair. You are when you're looking older, saying the same words that you did in UFO Diaries. You see, I caught you slipping, didn't I? By the way, so now he's addressing my question because, remember the Shannon question? This is a sketch done by Shannon. So Richard wants to clear it immediately. By the way, Jim Shannon, Mike, the artist, army colonel, anthropologist, I discuss at length in Monuments, is a guy. Okay, now he's trying to tell us. Hoagland's hinting, even though he's answering, obviously letting us know her name ain't Shannon, because therefore he's applicating fault to the script as being misleading. You following me so far? This is important. And I think Mr. Shackelford would get a kick out of this. Thank you, Mr. Shackelford. It's a blessing you and Mr. Sellier gave me. Why? Okay. All right. So, her name's not Shannon. Thus, the legitimacy of my question. Mr. Hoagland, why aren't you answering my post? Is this woman, I asked about an earlier reply, named Shannon? No, he got into, you know, the recreations and then told us who Jim Shannon really is. Okay, well, we didn't get a Jim Shannon. We got a Shannon, and then immediately showed her. So in our minds, her name was Shannon, which is what? If for the investigator, now she holds up a picture, a book. The Sphinx holds the face next to it. Do you notice that?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, remember what I said before about the snippets being an identity? Always looking toward these faces? That's not a lie. Look in the pictures I put up in evidence. You will see a sphinx head always looking toward or at one of these faces. While Lotus in this one, he ain't looking at the face. Who's he looking at? In that evidence picture, the sphinx that she's holding the face of Mars up to. It's on the evidence page. And then she goes, huh. And
looking right back at her, isn't it?
Thank you. That is a code. Why? If I'm right, that sphinx is an identity, and the identity is looking at her, and the identity is looking at her. Why? Oh, I'm not going to she's so sexy. I want to get with that. No. I want to know who the hell she is. It makes this a question. In essence, it's a subliminal coded message of a representation of an identity trying to figure out who she is. Incredible. Incredible. What are the odds? All right? So, now, back that out of the way, if you can, here we go again, people. That out of the way on from now 6/5. I mean, yeah, June 5th. Remember, the day before 666. But anyway, that out of the way. If you can find the name, email, phone number of the actual segment producer who did this Cydonia part of the series, I can then call, email him, and hopefully get more info on where this second face came really from. Carry on. So not only again, he's still encouraging me to find out the producers, do the legwork for him. Though, didn't he just say that he just did a little bit of research into this video?
And he still sure needs did.
Me... You know, I mean, we got him in that same post on that same day. So, you didn't research that. You did research into the video, but you still want me to find the producer's name and number and give this to you and then say, carry on? Carry on. Gee, it looks like I have been for the past 5.5 years, haven't I, Oakland? All right?
All right.
So, we're going on.
All right, Gary, thank you, Mike. Hold on, Gary. We're going to take a break here, and then we'll pick it right back up where you left off. So hold your spot there, and everybody will be back in a few minutes. I'm Michael Vera. This is Late Night in the Midlands. Co-hosting with me is Glenn Kennedy, our guest, Gary the Mad Martian, and we'll be back in just a few minutes.